Good morning. Oh my, welcome to Pleasant Hill. We'll find our way to our seats this morning. We have a lot of great things in store for you today and don't want you to miss out. Please make sure today to check your announcements. We have some important information for our ladies of the church with the Gals of Grace and the Secret Sister, and there's some sign-up things that you need to be doing, so please check our announcements regarding that. And also, just please keep an eye out over the next 2 or 3 weeks. Watch your church website, ph.church. You're going to see some updates and some things get a little fresher on there. So we're going to have an exciting year and what's transpiring. So a lot of great things in store. So stay tuned. A lot of good things taking place. Want to welcome especially today our friends, our guests, and our family members that are here, you that are worshiping with us online this morning. We want to welcome you into God's house as we prepare our hearts and minds to give our praise to the Lord today. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this place. But more importantly, we thank you for these people that make up your church. Father, we pray you would pour out your spirit today, that we would know your presence, that we would sense that. Lord, that you would minister to our hearts and to our needs, and that as we leave out from this place today, that we would go with a fresh and renewed assurance that you are with us and that you are sending us out for your kingdom purposes. Minister to us today and to those that are here present and to those of our family that are not able to be with us today. We lift them up to you as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Just remain seated for just a few minutes this morning. We have a couple of other things that we'd like to share with you.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning, church. Man, it is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. Listen, I want to talk to you real quick. I want to let you know that this past week, God did something. God did something. He did it on your behalf. Your prayers, your financial contributions, your thoughts. Because Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, we took a group of 12 to Atlanta, Georgia for our Passion Conference. And I have already been asked this morning, how was Passion? How was Passion? And I'm just going to tell you, it's almost too hard to put into words. I understand now, and I've always said this to my wife, that we undersell the glory of heaven. We undersell the glory of heaven. We put in our minds that we go to heaven and we're sitting on a cloud and we're looking down and we're, you know, asking God to watch over our loved ones. And I just, it's so much more. It's so much more. And this past week, we got a glimpse of heaven. We got a glimpse of heaven. Of course, it was your, you know, fun times and your laughter and your, you know, joking around and but then, you know, it was good speakers and good music, but it was so much more than just those things, because the media there at times would just pull the music back and you got to hear 55,000 voices lifting up the name of the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the name of the Lord, who was and is to come. And I'm telling you guys, just like we could never understand the completeness and the totality of heaven, I could come back and try to explain to you what this conference was like, but I would undersell it every single time. But we've got a short video we want to show you this morning. So if you guys will go ahead and roll that video for us.
Oh, God's
reality. The song that you're hearing is
Pastor 24 has been.
Tim Tebow prayed for me, by the way.
And in another place, the scripture says, they will look upon.
You got to see students getting in the word and raising hands and tears fall, voices lifted. That's an 80-foot cross down there. So the theme of passion was the desire of my soul. And, you know, the saying, actions speak louder than words. We got to see the desires of the souls of 55,000 18 to 25-year-olds. There's nothing I could ever do to fully explain to you the glimpse of heaven that we were able to see. And we owe you and your prayers and your contributions a humongous thank you this morning. Because of the love of Pleasant Hill Church, we were able to book our hotel rooms, and we were able to pay for all 12 tickets at no cost for our students. So all they had to worry about was food, and we ate. We ate. Oh, but man, I'm telling you, we got more than bread alone. We got more than bread alone. I wish that I could come back and just give it all to you. And that's our commission, right? That's our commission from the time that those who walked with Jesus, they spent their time with Jesus, and Jesus said, go. And so now when we get to go here and they pray us out, we're sent back to, there was 1,600 college campuses represented. So the commission was to go out to your campus. Well, guess what? I'm not a college student, but I have a campus. I have a campus. Listen, you know, I'm going to go off script a little bit here and say that I'm proud of our church. I'm proud of our church because we've endured some storms, some high tides, and we survived moments where we didn't necessarily know if the last time we locked these doors would be our last time to lock these doors. But our church stood on scriptural truth. And for those of you who have come here on the backside of that, we're so glad to have you. Welcome to the Pleasant Hill Church family. But to God be the glory. You know, a lot of the students and people who went, you know, made social media posts and tagged me and Emily and Chris and Miss Gail in it. And, you know, I was like, thank you, thank you. And we didn't do anything. We could not have. We could have never. All we did was drive a van that I hope I never have to drive again, by the way. I got an amen from the pastor. But, man, to be where we are today, to have come from where we came from, and now, for me personally, I used to be the youth pastor here from 2015 to 2017, and when I had to step away, I didn't want to step away. I can promise you I didn't want to give that up. Ministry is my calling. I get to do it every Sunday, even though I may not have a title. I may not be the youth pastor. I may not be the college minister, even though I'm blessed enough to get to pour into these kids' lives anyway. I still have a ministry. You guys still have a ministry. You guys still have a campus. It's not just Pleasant Hill. It's your jobs. It's your homes, and that's where it's got to start. And this generation that I speak about is so special because there's many of us here that are today's yesterday. And there's many of us here, like my two baby girls, that are today's tomorrow. What's special about the group that we took? They are today's today and today's tomorrow. And there's an epidemic in the church that these people are just slipping through the cracks. You've got the youth group, and it might be going strong, but then it's like, okay, we've done our part. Here you go. Jump on in the deep end. Some people may not be ready to swim yet. So this year is the year that Pleasant Hill gets intentional with its college ministry, and I'm so thankful to be a part of that with Miss Gail Davis, wherever she is. Miss Gail. So we're blessed. God sent us a pastor to lead our flock. And all he does, I can assure you, is this right here. And anything that doesn't align doesn't belong at Pleasant Hill. And we wish to be a reflection of that for our college students. And we wish to be a reflection of that for our youth group. We wish to be a reflection of that for our men's ministry, for our women's ministry, the gals of grace. You women have been carrying Pleasant Hill for a little while. We're strong Christian believers here at Pleasant Hill, and I'm thankful for each and every one of you. God bless you this morning.
Would you join me? Let's stand together and just greet one another in the Lord this morning. We are so glad you're here, and let's prepare our hearts to worship by recognizing that God came in the door, in your heart and in the one next to you.
Good morning, Pleasant Hill. Let's all get back to our seats and worship.
Out of the shadows, bound for the gallows, a dead man walking, to love came calling. Rise up.
He's either got a bad cold or a flu, so.
To let you know, actually some of the songs I've chosen, we have all have chosen, is sometimes for the drum, but the drummer is not here, but we still need to pray for him, as our team say. And also, if there is no one except Kyle or Didi, would you still praise God?
Amen.
Yes, that's the spirit. If one of us are absent, we still have to praise God, because he is worthy of all praise. So let's give God the glory. Yeah.
Because of who he is and what he's done.
Yes. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how stands and
just your voices.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Oh my, thank you. Thank you so much for leading us to the throne room this morning. And you know, the thing when you're talking about giving God the glory and giving Him the praise, I hope y'all realize this morning that the worship team goes far beyond this stage. Amen? Yes. Amen? Yes. Amen? There's but one audience and you're not it. Huh? And so as we come into this place, just remember, you're part of the worship team here. Everyone. There's no bench warmers at Pleasant Hill, amen? We're all in the game. We're all on the march. We're all on the team, and we all have a part to play. And when we come together to worship, you're part of it. You're part of it. So when we come to worship, bring it. Huh? Bring it. You never know when the person next to you is going to be blessed and receive encouragement for what comes out of your mouth and out of your heart during a season of worship. Because I can tell you, Gail, as I was standing there, there was moments I just had to be quiet to listen to those voices. I needed that couple of days, you know. And God used those students to pour into me, you see. And so never forget that. You're a song wherever you go, amen. And so you need to bring it. You need to bring it. What a joy it was. And again, I want to thank you all for letting this old guy go hang out with these young folks and kid myself just a little bit. And, you know, feel like I kind of fit in. They were gracious. They were very gracious to let me tag along. Thank you. Thank you to our college group here for allowing me to be a part and just to hang out for a little bit. They didn't kick me to the curb or anything or leave me hanging down a dark alley because I was a little surprised about that. I probably would have, but thank y'all for that. We had a blessed season of worship just like we get to have here when we get to come together on Sunday mornings. I just hope that you know how precious these few moments in worship and praise and in prayer, they really are that we have together. Because sometimes that's just the juice I need to get through the week, amen? To hear God's voice. And I need this. I need you in that. Because the Lord's within you and He works through you. So what a blessing it is to be in a place where people are giving God praise because great things happen. Great things happen. There are things that we'll never know that were expressed and that were completed and that were accomplished during those moments that are still working out in the hearts and lives of those that were present. There's nothing special necessarily about I need to be careful there. There is something special about that passion team and that group that was there. Some gifts and some ministries were there, but the main thing is they gathered in the name of Jesus. And you could sense that. Just like you can when you walk in these doors. We need to never forget that. And we need to cherish it. One of the key themes that's been a part of that group or verses for, I think, what did they say, 26 years or something like that? I actually remember some of the first things that they did a little while ago. But their key passage was Isaiah 26:8 that kind of launched in to that ministry. Yes, in the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. And here's the key part. The desire of our soul is for your name. For your name. They talk a whole lot about the renown. Those that are in the name and known for the name of God. We desire and to know the name of God. In this Old Testament context, this word that is precious, that I even tremble a bit myself to say, and those of the day and the time would never utter the word Yahweh. Because the personal name of God, oh, you better be careful. I kind of remember, I saw this week, Caleb was there, you know, out of school this week, and he was watching one of the little Chronicles of Narnia movies. Y'all remember that C.S. Lewis stuff they've made into movies, books, and series, and it talks about, and they have this God figure that's Aslan that represents the Almighty, this God thing, and they're talking about Aslan, the lion, and he would kind of come and go and do his own thing. You couldn't control him. Huh? You can't control him. And so they asked one that was kind of close to him, this little girl named Lucy. They asked about this lion Aslan, and you know, you don't just walk up and pet a lion, do you? You know, my dad next door, he has a little kitty cat, you know, and she earns her keep. She keeps the mice outside, right? You know, and all of that, and around the house, she's a little black cat with a little white stripe. We call her Oreo. Right down. And so I don't mind going up and petting her, but you got to watch, you know. You don't just pet her any old time. You know how cats are, right? Huh? You don't just pet, you pet them when they want to be petted, amen? Otherwise, they have a kind of a vicious way of letting you know, huh? You don't just walk up and pet a lion, amen? Huh? Unless you're crazy. You don't walk up and pet. And they asked little Lucy about, they could see the lion out there as he was coming and going. They were asking, like, is he safe? She said, oh, no. He's not a tame lion. My friends, if you think you can domesticate Jesus, mm-mm. He's the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. He does as he will. But thank God, like little Lucy says, but he's good. Huh? But he's good. He's good. We need to grab hold of the goodness of God as he pours out into our hearts of life. And desire, the desire of our soul, Lord, is for your name. And he's good. He gives me and you that name. And Lord, for the remembrance of you. You know, it's amazing, Kyle, when we got home, I was a little bit tired. No, I was a lot tired. And my goodness, you know, I think they had about 32 sessions a day, something like that. And they all lasted 2 hours long. You do the math, you know that's an exaggeration, right? Some of you have gotten to know me. My spiritual gift is sarcasm, amen? So y'all pray for me. Pray for my family, right, Julie? I was worn out. And how many of you know that's when the devil loves to find you, huh? I gotten home, and I drove the way home, and I was just worn out, just giving slap out, and got home, and I wasn't there any time, and it all started to overwhelm me. I was spiritually, I was full, but physically, I was drained. And I began to think about all the stuff that I needed to do. The long list of phone calls that I needed to return that I had kind of pushed away for about 36 hours. And all the places I need to go and things I need to do, and you have those things in your life. And I begin to get a little anxious. Now, I got a lot anxious. I get uptight. I thank God that he's given me somebody to hold me up when I'm down like that, that puts up with me. It's not easy sometimes. I thank God for that patience. I would have killed me already, amen? But then last night, I begin to think about, what's the desire of my soul? What's the passion that I choose? You know, we get to choose that, huh? What's the passion that I choose in my life? You like making choices? Uh-oh, I just asked you a question, so you have to make a choice. Our life is full of making choices. It's full of making choices. Somewhere around a little over, we met about, what, 27 years ago, give or take, and working on around about 26 years and stuff, and, you know, come this, you know, after 26, it's starting to get serious, you know. It's kind of getting serious, but you know, but you know, we've made some choices together. A lot of choices. But then there's simple things. You make choices every day, right? What am I going to wear today? It's a choice. Now that's a first world problem. There's a lot of people that just wish they had something to wear today, man. We need to be careful. What am I going to eat for lunch? Some of you are going to have a big fight after we leave here today, right? You know, not because of where you're going, because nobody can make a choice. Huh? You know what I mean? Where do you want to go? If you want to find out where somebody doesn't want to go, just make a suggestion, right? Yeah? Watch it get shot down. I mean, just right there and in a hurry. We make decisions all the time. But that's another first world choice, isn't it? You know, as we were standing in long lines to get a little something to eat because there was nowhere else to go, it's crazy that we took over downtown Atlanta. We put a strain on downtown Atlanta. Can you imagine that? All the people that were there to support that and the folks that were there and the kids literally put us, there was nowhere to go to eat. What a place to be found. They were feeding food in the stadium. The lines when they first started were 2 hours long nearly. I began to wonder, well, what am I going to eat? Because, you know, I don't wait 2 hours for something to eat, you know? Amen? Y'all pray for me. And so, I was getting uptight about it. People around us today that don't have anything. It's a first world choice. What am I going to eat? Then I begin to think about all those other things and the pressures. Am I going to get it done today? Am I going to be able to measure up? Am I going to be good enough? Do I have what it takes? Will I be respected today? Will I be loved today? Am I even worth the effort? Am I worth being celebrated? Am I worth being loved? Am I worth being respected? And maybe that's a little lofty. Am I even worth being noticed? Maybe that's too much. Am I even valuable enough to be laughed at? When I take a wrong turn. Maybe not. Am I even enough just to be hated? You know, maybe I think the worst thing in the world is to not be noticed. How many of you felt like that? Not even worth enough to be despised. You know, it was something. Y'all remember Louis when he came out. Louis Giglio is the one that's been involved with Passion for years and years and years. And he's spoken in front of these big crowds countless times with different venues, different events all around the country. Big stadiums early on when they started out in fields and places like that and in all kinds of places that they have been. And I think he was probably a little sick that night. I think he was feeling bad and he walked out and all of a sudden, I don't even think he meant to do it, but he made the confession that he didn't feel good enough. Because he said his wife, Shelley, told him, go ahead, it's going to be okay. I want to give you just a couple of things before we come together around this table. And I hope you understand. I don't think we can really understand, but I hope you can begin to appreciate how valuable it is that we get to approach this moment together in remembrance. In remembrance of His name. We're reminded in Psalm 121:8, the Lord keeps watch over you as you come and go, both now and forever. I want to remind you this morning that you are noticed by the Father. This world, I don't care what position you do or don't hold, this world can make you feel small, amen? I was sharing, I remember a time several years ago. In fact, it was one of the first mission trips I ever went on, a little short-term mission trip down to Belize to put a roof on a church that had been blown off during a hurricane there on the east coast of Belize. And we went down and we were going to put that roof on. But when we went down with a construction crew and, you know, there were several experts in different areas, a contractor and electricians, different ones that were there. And, of course, there was me. I'm the guy what twits the boards, you know what I mean? And so we went down, but we got there the first day and got to the job site to find that all the materials had been stolen. And so all the roofing materials, the rafters, everything was gone. And so the pastor got a couple of his biggest guys. And they sent us off and said, y'all go have a fun day and come back and we'll start after that. And so they went back and, you know, miraculously those things appeared back on site after they went around and visited a few people. God works in mysterious ways. I'm glad I wasn't a part of that. But while we were waiting, they took us off to one of the little islands. It's more of like a touristy area that's off the coast of Belize. Cape Hawker is the island that was there. And we kind of pulled around and chartered a little boat. And they took us off snorkeling off the barrier reef. One of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. Clear water, all the fish that were there. And everyone was kind of snorkeling around on the inside of that reef. And, you know, all kinds of different kinds of fish and lobster and all kinds of things were there. And then I noticed a little cut in the reef that water was about 30 feet deep, but it looked like it was just right there. And I wanted to see the other side of that reef, I thought. And so I snorkeled on around. I was about 100, 150 yards away from the group, which is not really wise. And I swam out over the edge of that reef. I've never been a big guy, but I've never felt so small. I know what the abyss looks like. I saw it. I wasn't thinking of it then. I was thinking how quickly I could get back to the group. But the Father who watches over me made that reef. Amen? Did you hear me? Did you hear me? That hole in the water, the Father who watches over me made that hole. He made the mountains that tower above us. He makes it all. And as we begin to consider who He is, how great He is, it changes things. You know, Tim Tebow walked up on the stage. He was one of many. He's a game changer, right? Our Father's a game changer. He watches over us. He watches over you. You're noticed. We remember that very familiar verse. Sometimes we see those great things in our lives and I'm not able to do this. But we're reminded, as Paul reminds the church, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. You have what it takes. You see. God's put some of you right up against some hard stuff. Amen. I've got to meet a few of you. I've been praying for some of you. Some of you, I don't know, I don't even have a clue, but I know God's put you right up against some hard stuff. I'm here to tell you today, in Christ Jesus, you have what it takes in Him. And you need to be encouraged. You need to be encouraged. In the Gospel of Luke chapter 15, the Bible reminds us, likewise, I say to you, there's a joy in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. Not only are you noticed, but you're celebrated. Ever had anybody forget your birthday? Maybe you're my age or older and you kind of wish people would forget your birthday a little bit. You're celebrated. He'll never forget you. Your pastor might. I don't want to, but I'm only a human guy. I'm far from perfect. To which my family says, yeah, amen. He'll never let you down. And you're celebrated. You're celebrated. You're celebrated. I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one. Guess how many you are? Huh? How many? You're one. Over one. Over one sinner who repents. In the Gospel of Luke chapter 12, verse 6, the Bible says, and not five sparrows sold for two copper coins. That's nothing. That's nothing. Pick up a couple of pennies, it's less than that. Are not five sparrows sold for two copper coins, and not one of them is forgotten before God. Not one of them is forgotten before God, but the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Some of you, that's easier than others, I understand. But very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, for you are of more value than many sparrows. You're so much more than just noticed. You're celebrated. And get this, you matter. You count. You count. You count for something. You're significant in the kingdom of God. You matter. I know some of you are up against some hard things, but God has not turned his face away, nor is he afraid of what you're facing. You matter. You count. Don't give up, for the God who is over the abyss is with you. Don't quit, because he'll never quit. Don't give up. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. God sending his Son into the world not to judge the world. He's not here to get you. He's here to get you. He's not here to beat you up. He's here to wrap his arms around you. For God so loved you. God so loved you. You're loved. You're loved. So much more than noticed. So much more than celebrated. You're loved. He put you first. He moved you to the front of the line. You're loved, amen? Somebody ought to get happy. You're loved. I mean, some of you, we don't even like you. But he loves you, amen. Amen. You're loved. We need to remember that he's put his name on us. We need to remember that his promises for us are not dried up and are not finished. We need to remember that the God of heaven and heaven's army has taken notice and he loves us. Paul wrote to the church these words in 1 Corinthians. And I want you to consider this. Remember. In the way of your judgments, back in Isaiah before we get there. In the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. The desire of our soul is for your name and for the remembrance of you. Keep that in mind. For the remembrance of you. How cool is this? The desire of our souls is that we remember him. We remember the truth of his word. We remember the power of his promise. We remember what is in store for us. But get this, he's remembered us too. Amen? He's remembered you. He's not forgotten you. He's remembered us as well. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, the word of God reminds us, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that Jesus, the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, the Bible says he broke it. Let that settle in for just a moment. The bread of life. Took the bread and he broke it. We didn't crucify Christ on a cross. Christ crucified himself on a cross for us. The Bible says he broke it. And he said, take, eat. This is my body which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Some of you this morning, you need to remember. Life has hit you hard. You need to remember some things. You need to remember his favor on you. For as often the Bible says, as you eat this bread and drink this cup, what do? You proclaim him. And so he said, in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. You remember those words in the garden? Father, take this cup. He knew, didn't he? It wasn't an easy thing. But then he said, Father, your will be done and not mine. This cup from which we receive today is the cup that Jesus didn't set down. When he held that cup, he held you up. Amen? And he holds you up today. He holds you up. Verse 27 says, therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. What does that mean? Don't come here not believing Jesus. Do you believe him? If you do, he says, come with boldness. Come with boldness to the throne of grace. He says, let a man examine himself. And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup, for he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. How many of you know it's not what you can do? You can't get ready for this, but he can get you ready. Amen? Do you believe him? Do you believe him? For this reason, many are weak and sick among you. Many sleep or have passed on. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. My friends, do not receive from him carelessly. Do you love him? He says, if you love me, keep my commandments. He says, my commandments are not hard or burdensome. They're given to you to bless you and bring favor. Do you love them? But when we are judged, we're chastened by the Lord. Why? So that he can destroy us? No. So that we will not be condemned by the world. I want you to remember something today. If there's something on your heart and mind that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt you need to lay down, this is the time for you. If there's forgiveness that you need in your heart, praise God, we have a God who forgives. If you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive. All you need to do today is come believing in Jesus and confessing. The invitation is yours. I want to invite our worship team to come this morning, if you would. Those that are going to be assisting as we serve in remembrance today, if you would come as well, join us around the table. Bread of life, broken for you. Take and receive and be thankful. The blood of Jesus shed for you. For the forgiveness of sin. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending us Jesus. Lord Jesus, thank you for doing the will of your Father. Holy Spirit, thank you for communicating the love and the grace of Jesus and of the Father to us now. We remember you. Thank you for remembering us first. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, I want to invite you to come and to receive from the Lord today. If you'd like to come and pray, you come and pray. But we want you to know that the gift of Christ has been given to you. We offer to you just simply as being a part of the kingdom of God, as a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. But Jesus himself offers to you this grace. Would you stand with me? You're going to come from the outside and you'll receive the bread. Take that and dip into the cup and receive from him and remember that he has remembered you. Thank you.
I give my life to the potter's hand. Call me, guide me, lead me, walk beside me. I give my life to the potter's hand.
Of what you have done, we thank you for reaching down from heaven and remembering us. May we ever remember you and give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Use me.